Business will be the Pledge of Allegiance. Pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Call roll.
Richard Anderson.
Here.
Ronald Bergstrom.
Here.
George Bryant.
Was here.
Leo Kukunis.
Yeah.
Christopher Kenega.
Here.
Thomas Keys.
Here.
Marcia King.
Here.
Thomas Lynch.
Here.
Teresa Martin.
She's out in the hall.
Okay. Well, she's here.
Yes, she's here.
John Omen.
Here.
Paul Pilcher.
Here.
Anthony Scalise. Fred Schilp.
Here.
Charlotte Striebel.
Here.
Julia Taylor. We have a quorum with 95.46% of the delegates present, counting that Delegate Martin and Bryant are in the building.
Excuse me, Mr. Speaker.
Yes, recognize Delegate.
Thank you. I'd like to make a motion that we suspend the proceedings at this point so that we can allow the Finance Committee to go back into session so that they can finish up their work, coming back in for to reconvene.
Would I have time on that? Maybe 4:45?
Excuse me. Do you want to give a time on that, Tom?
Time on that would be, yeah, yes, 4:45, come back into session, please.
Okay. Do I hear, you have a second. Anybody comment on that, Leo?
Just for discussion purposes, and so I understand what's going on, the Finance Committee has to provide us today with a recommendation. Today,
no.
They don't.
They don't.
So why do we necessarily, it doesn't seem like our agenda is that complex here. Why wouldn't we rush through this and leave in a half an hour and allow them not to be under a time constraint? Because it sounds like they have a lot of deliberations.
Well, I'll defer to the chairman of the Finance Committee on that answer.
Yeah, Mr. Speaker, you know, in due consideration of the audience that's here, in due consideration of the fellow members of the Assembly and Commissioners, I think that's an excellent suggestion, Leo. And my committee was willing to stay after, as well as you. If anybody in the audience or in the Assembly wants to listen to our common diatribe about the budget, I would feel less constrained and less hurried under those circumstances.
Okay,
it's an excellent suggestion.
Is that all right with the
My personal opinion is that we have to vote on this budget at our next regularly scheduled meeting, which is April 15th. I would prefer to have this discussion today so that we can have something to think about over the next 2 weeks, as well as possibly help us come up with certain conclusions.
We concur.
I think this is very important work, and I would actually, if we need to, suspend the order of business that the Assembly is going to do today and add this discussion instead.
Well, now let's just take a minute here. The Finance Committee will report favorably or unfavorably on the budget when it presents the budget to the Assembly 2 weeks from today, which is how I understand the normal course of business. Now, if you want a sneak preview of their deliberations, you can stay until after the meeting. But
yeah, we're going to meet today, either now or after the Assembly meeting. So the question is whether you think that more people would prefer to have, I presume most of you would like to hear the discussion, and maybe some of the audience would too. So the question is, when do they want to hear it? We're going to have the discussion no matter what, right?
I just don't want to be under a time constraint. I mean, if we're 4:45, it's on the course of day. So I would prefer to have the meeting of the Assembly.
I think the Finance Committee is in unanimous. We would like to have our assembly meeting go first.
What's that?
We as the Finance Committee would prefer to do this at the end of the meeting and expedite the meeting as reasonably
quickly
as possible.
Well, you're going to have to get Mr. Keys from Sandwich to withdraw his motion.
No, not necessarily. Mr. Keys, can you have his motion and get it seconded and bring it forward?
Okay. There is a...
I've counted my side of the votes.
Seeing, recognizing the Finance Committee has a majority of the weighted vote, we'll see how this goes. All right, well, there's a motion on the floor, and it's been moved and seconded. Okay, if there's no further discussion, all in favor of Tom's motion of recessing, say aye. Okay. Opposed? No. The noes have it. Okay, so we will then commence with the normal business of the Assembly, which is the approval of the calendar business. Do I hear a motion?
So moved.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor say aye. Okay, opposed? All right, now we need the approval of the Journal of March 18, 2009. I know you've all read it and memorized it.
Mr. Speaker, yep. I have one correction.
Okay.
Okay, on page 23, it says what Mark said was that there was a person brought in house. It should be Maggie. Okay, just the wrong name. No big deal.
Okay. Well,
that's the only
okay.
I have.
With that correction, do I have a second? Been moved and seconded to approve the calendar, to approve the Journal of March 18th with the correction from Delegate Anderson. No further discussion. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, now we have communications from, we have some brief communications from the Board of County Commissioners. I recognize the Chairman of the County Commissioners, Sheila Lyons. And Mary Pat Flynn.
Good afternoon, everyone. What am I doing with this?
Just, I would just read it if you want, or just say that Stacy was in to talk about the opinions for prevention.
Is it too loud? I do want to just share something with you from the Children's Cove. Stacy was with us today, and some of you might be seeing around the county, I noticed it in front of the TDY North at the Rotary in Hyannis, these little pinwheels stuck in the ground, and they're sort of in this V shape, you know, the little whirlywigs. That is an awareness campaign on sexual abuse that is being done by the Children's Cove. So I just wanted to let you know that the Children's Cove was established in 1997. It's a freestanding, child-friendly facility designed, staffed, and equipped to provide comprehensive and coordinated multidisciplinary services to child sexual abuse victims and their families. And these services, specialized by discipline, are provided by member agencies, which include Barnstable County, the Cape and Islands District Attorney's Office, Cape Cod Hospital, the Department of Children and Families, the Department of Mental Health, as well as local and state law enforcement. So during April, Sexual Assault Awareness Month, Children's Cove is dedicated to raising the public awareness about sexual violence to educate communities and individuals on how to prevent sexual violence. Pinwheels for Prevention is a public awareness campaign sponsored by Children's Cove designed to bring attention to child sexual abuse in our community. It is intended to show the public in a very dramatic way that child sexual abuse happens everywhere and encourages us to look on prevention as part of the plan to break the cycle. So please do your part not only this month but at all times to protect our children. Children cannot prevent this abuse by themselves. It is our responsibility as adults to take notice, to learn, and to speak up when we see inappropriate behaviors. So I read that to all of you and to the television audience to let people know that that is what Children's Cove is about and that that is what they are there for. So with that, I really have not much else. We've been here with all of you today at public hearing, and it's been most fascinating. And Mark, Pat, would you like to, do you have anything first?
I yield my time so they have more time to deliberate on the budget.
Yes, okay, that's right, and I will do the same.
And I only have one thing, Mr. Speaker, and that is, irony of ironies, we have to submit a supplemental budget ordinance today. The good news, that's the bad news. The good news is it is not new money. We are using the appropriated reserve account that's in the budget. There's a line item that specifies that. That's in the shared cost piece of the budget. There's $20,000 in there, and we need this money for two basic functions. One for information technology. In implementing the phone system, we incurred some additional bills that we need $8,000 to cover. And in the facilities budget, especially in both the public safety building where the sheriff had not vacated it sooner than we expected, and also at the Children's Cove, we need some additional costs for both the electricity service and the natural gas for heating. So there's about a $12,000 request for that. Totals $20,000.
Excuse me, what's your time frame on that, Mark? Is it something should be done within the next cycle here, or can it wait?
It can wait. It needs to be done, obviously, before the end of the fiscal year, okay. But either April or May is fine.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if this is the time to engage in a budget debate with the county commissioners, but we'll wait till we produce our budget. But if you have any questions about anything we've discussed, or Leo?
This is probably for Mark. There was some discussion earlier in regards to the county dispatch, and I know first I'd like an update on if there is anything on the sheriff's department going to the state, number one. And number two, could you enlighten me on what's going to happen with the county dispatch if, in the event, the sheriff's department does go to the state?
There was a hearing a couple of Thursdays ago at the State House regarding the governor's proposal for the assumption of the remaining county associated sheriffs, and that was very well attended. Commissioner Lyons and Commissioner Flynn were there, as well as I, and we gave testimony. And I think in general, there were a number of sheriffs there, and they were obviously testifying in favor of the bill, as were we, with some modifications. Some of the counties were, I think Norfolk and Plymouth specifically testified against the bill. They had some concerns about it. But I think there is a strong impetus at the state level to get that done this year. So we still anticipate that that bill will be passed in some way, shape, or form, and hopefully it will be with the modifications that, working with Senator O'Leary's office, we have proposed. And the sheriffs did bring that issue up, and I believe they feel confident, and as confident as they can, that there will not be any impact on the ancillary services that some of the sheriff's departments offer. And in fact, that was one of Senator O'Leary's amendments that he proposed. He's proposed some language that would kind of ensure that those ancillary services could continue.
Okay, is there any other questions for the Commissioner? Tom?
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. This is to the commissioners. Today, we received a letter from the commissioners dated April 1st, and in this letter, this was the one to Mr. Ullman, who's chairman of the Finance Committee. There was a, let me see, on the bottom of page one at the bottom, this is in regards to the deeds tax increase. It says, we felt the modest amount will not materially affect a buyer's decision. There was discussion about whether this tax is going to be borne on the buyer or the seller. Has there been clarity on who actually will pay that bill? This indicates that it's a buyer, but I believe there's been debate as to who actually will pay
We know statutorily, and I think Mr. Neitz mentioned that, and we have since clarified with Register of Deeds, Jack Mead, that in fact, statutorily, it's on the seller. The seller is responsible for it.
Thank you.
Yes.
Mark, there was some discussion at our last meeting about the capital expenses, which totaled $250, I think, $225. And then Tom Keyes had suggested we might be able to delay, and then I think Diane was going to inquire about that. Could you bring us up to date on what's the deal there?
Yeah, actually, I did, because I heard.
Could we cut that and?
I heard this mentioned when you guys were discussing it. Actually, in previous years, when we've had money, as you know, we have placed in the budget capital items, and that's, the capital items are in a separate capital fund with the understanding that eventually you will issue bonds to cover your expenses in the capital fund. And what we've been doing over time since we've had money was we've been covering those at the end of the year with cash. In the 2010 budget, there are $235,000 in capital expenditures, but those are assumed to be covered with bonds at this point. And it's very likely, of course, that we will not, either this year or next year, be in a position to cover those expenses with remaining cash. We just won't have it. So the answer, I think, that you mean is if you take the 235 out, you'll have to take the 235 in expenditures out of the expenditure side, but you'll have to take the 235 off the revenue side as well, because you won't have bonds to cover. So you'll reduce the budget, but you won't save general fund money, is what the goal is, I think.
So we can't, there's no advantage to, in cutting. Okay.
There's no advantage to the general fund, which is really what you're talking about.
Thank you. I think I understand it. Yeah, right, okay.
That's exactly.
Too bad.
Can I just ask on that? So, Mark, did you have in there monies to cover the bonded indebtedness that you would have put out?
Well, the good news on bonded indebtedness is I think last week we just made our final bond issue payment. So any monies on the debt service side are assumed to be for any bond issues that we'll have to issue for capital expenditures that we did this year and next year, assuming there are any.
So what is that sum?
I think there was $175,000 in there that'll cover principal and interest on any bond issues that we do.
So if we wanted to cut $175,000 and delay capital expenditures for up to 2 years, that would be that's where the revenue source is.
You'd have to leave some money in the debt service issue, because in 2009, we're doing capital expenditures this year. We're doing the new phone system. We're doing a couple of things. We will not be in a position at the end of 2009 to cover those expenditures with cash, so we will need to issue bonds sometimes within the next, you have a two-year period, you can do short-term financing over 2 years, and sometime within that two-year period you'll have to issue long-term debt to cover those expenditures, and we'll need some funding in the debt service line item to cover that.
So if we were just talking about the 275, what would it be to carry that?
To cover the, I'm sorry, the 275?
The 235.
235. Just off the top of my head, Tom, I don't know. I'd have to sit down and look at it.
Is he trying to cover? When you say we need Julia. Some, sorry. when you say we need some money on that debt service line, is that to cover things we've already spent money on?
That's correct. Phones? Out of the capital fund. Yes.
Mark, are you going to be here for the rest of the Finance Committee meeting?
Oh, God, I hope not. But, I will stay, because I'm dying to see how it turns out.
What I'm saying is you'll be available to answer these questions to the Finance Committee when they reconvene.
I hope there aren't any, but, yes, I'll be here.
And the rest of us can go to have dinner, and you'll be stuck. But that's okay. So, with that, is there any other non-finance questions? Or Tom, you have a... No, whatever.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Actually, this is finance. Mark, in relative to, are we going to have a surplus at the end of this year, or I'm sorry, fiscal year 2010, considering that our expected revenues are below what we actually believe they're going to be, we have to actually have that little bit of a buffer. Do you know what? It's hard to say what. Where our expected revenues have to be below what the actual is going to be. The auditors make sure that we do have a buffer there, because if we don't receive that amount, we run into a problem. That's the money I'm talking about with the 235 potential of going towards capital projects or deferred projects. Is there an opportunity for us to do a supplemental at the end of the year to use whatever that amount's going to be for some of these line items to allow us some type of flexibility in this budget process. Maybe not a fair question, but I think you understand where I'm coming from.
I'm not sure I do, but the budget itself is balanced, at least the way it was submitted from the commissioners, and we've always submitted a balanced budget, and we've always produced a balanced budget after the end of all the deliberations and things, and that's required when the budget, because there's one final step, has to go to the County Government Finance Review Board. That's part of state law, and it gets approved there. And so it's balanced. So what we have depended on over these past few years, since we really made the charter change in 2000 that allowed us to do this, was to set up those reserve accounts. And that's what we've been using as our buffer. And of course, last year we had to use some of those reserves to dip in for the sheriff's retirees' health insurance. And you know, that's the only caution I have right now. That's the wild card out right there right now. We assume and we think and we're hopeful that we will be able to get the sheriff's takeover bill passed with some modifications, as I've said. But that is, you know, that's a wild card right now.
I have an understanding. So what you're saying is that the projected receipts for fiscal year 2010 are actual. It's budgeted right up to what you believe they're going to be in your forecast. There's not a buffer there of, say, $200,000 in case those receipts aren't realized. You use the reserve in case we don't receive as much receipts as you.
Yeah, there's no, I wouldn't call it a buffer in the budget. That's what we think we're going to realize in terms of revenues, and, you know, that's what we hope to. And usually that's where we're at. We're usually maybe over on some and under on some others, but usually we're pretty decent on the revenue line. It's been a lot tougher more recently, but we've been pretty decent in terms of our forecasting.
All right. My confusion was just with the municipal finance. State auditors don't allow for that.
Yeah,
it's
a little bit different for the county. The county's budgeting process is a little bit different.
Thank you, Mark.
Okay. Is there any other questions for the commissioners or Mark? If not, thank you very much.
May I just ask one question? How long do you think, when do you think the assembly will adjourn and the finance department would be convening?
Well, it depends on how long you keep talking.
Well, on that note, I'm going to leave now. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Are there any communications from public officials? Are there any communications from public officials? Hearing none, are there any communications from members of the public? Okay, the assembly will...
I got one.
Oh, excuse me, I'm sorry. I didn't see you.
Please. After sitting through the hearing,
you have to speak into the
last
microphone.
Year, her name. There was talk, and I thought the appointment of a outreach committee, because it becomes clear to me.
Could you identify yourself just for the record?
Oh, I'm sorry, Jerry Rappaport, League of Women Voters, and I did attend a meeting that I think Charlotte called on an outreach method. And I think as I hear people talk, we don't know enough about what the county does, and it doesn't register with enough of our constituents. So I hope that committee, that task force, will come to fruition, that's all.
Okay, thank you very much. Leah?
Ironically, that was one of the reasons that I ran for this seat. I watched the deliberations on that ordinance. I believe it was an ordinance that you guys voted in. And one thing that I promised the people of the town of Harwich, because many of them asked me when I was standing out at the polls, what is the Assembly of Delegates and what do they do? And one thing that I promised them is I said, I have no idea, but when I get there, I'll let you know. So I'm actually formulating, with one of the county commissioners, Bill Doherty, we're going to start a program on our local Harwich Channel 18. And it's going to be, Barnstable County 101. And I'm going to ask him some questions. He's going to ask me some questions. And what I was hoping to do is invite different members of the county government to come in from time to time and speak on things that relate, how they relate to our town specifically. And again, it's Channel 18 in the town of Harwich, so I think that most of the stuff is going to be strictly related to our town, but it'll certainly be good. And I'm hopefully, if I get a good reception of it, I'll encourage some of my other members to do it in their hometown, too.
Okay, thank you. Yes, Charlotte?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Speaker. In response to what Jerry is talking about, that committee was called by the committee of the, isn't that awful, the
Human Services?
No, the Government Regulations Committee. That was that committee, and it was supported by the members of different agencies. And we did say that we would reconvene after the first of the year. And since now, if I may, you are chairman of the Government Regulations, that you need to call that committee together again, because it was very well received, and the information was unbelievable. And I think that probably we have minutes of the meeting on record, and you could pick it up from there. But thank you, Jerry, because I think it is necessary that committee be reconvened.
I'll sit down with Diane. We're going to look at our schedule for the next month, which could be sort of, but we'll see. We'll get a meeting of that committee up and running, and we'll pick up where you left off. Okay. If there's nothing further, the assembly will now start with the reports from the committees. Do we have any of the reports from the committees? Okay. We do not. John?
We have an ongoing public hearing, and I'll report to the assembly and when that meeting is finished. Thank
you.
Okay.
If there's nothing further, then we will have a report from the clerk.
No report today. Thank you.
Wow. No report from the clerk. Okay. Do we have any other business to be brought before the assembly? Hearing none. Do I have a motion? I have a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Assembly is adjourned.
There's been a motion to reconvene the Finance Committee public hearing, and there's been a second. Do I need a vote? No, we're all in favor. Okay. Would the committee like to move to a round table so we can look at each other as we amiably grade? Or do you want to sit right here? That's fine. We're here? Okay, fine. All right. Tom, I think we left off with you.
Yeah. I just want to reiterate a couple of things, because we jumped right into cuts and moving money around and such. And, you know, when I started looking at this, I wanted to support the commissioners in maintaining their existing personnel, because I believe with existing personnel you can continue to deliver services. You may change some of the priorities or the because you might not get funding for one thing, but it enables you to, you know, go out into the community and send your housing person out in the community to meet with ZBAs or to meet with housing authorities. There are still lots of things that can be directed in terms of services or consulting or assistance, provided you have the people. Once you start cutting the people, then you don't necessarily have that body to go out there and work with folks. I was one who didn't want to support a reduction in the Economic Development Council. I saw the numbers that went in, because I felt that economic development should be one of our primary initiatives over the next year. But if in the spirit of compromise there needs to be something there, I'd be willing to look at that. I think that, again, the regionalization issues that have been articulated can be accomplished. With the energy and enthusiasm of the county commissioners, as they've been, and the leadership that they've been exhibiting, as well as the fact that there's staff from the commission and many other places that are also already working on, seven different, regional initiatives. So that's kind of where I was, coming from initially. We've been leaving the issue of the sheriffs off the table as it related to the tax. I know Julia has some thoughts on that, but that was kind of my basic feeling in looking at the basic issue. So I don't know if anyone else wants to make general statements before we go back to the specifics. But
I I'm worried. You know, I wouldn't mind.
Yeah, I'm really do support the commissioner's priorities in the long, but I'm afraid more in the long term, because I think that we could pass this budget as written, and we are then facing big money coming out of the reserve fund, a significant tax increase, and we don't even have any way to pay for the sheriff if that doesn't work. So that's why I can't vote really for the existing budget before me, because I'm really worried about next year and maybe the year after. Maybe we'll get rich and happy again, but in the short, if that doesn't happen. So I guess I am willing to make some significant cuts, happy that they don't really require job cuts, and then I can feel that we can go to the public and say, we've done what has to be done, and we're trying to get ourselves in a position where we can survive. But I would certainly want the assembly to not take a no new taxes, read my lips type of position. I would want us to acknowledge that if we lose the sheriff fight, we're going to have to raise the tax. Or at least we're going to have to seriously, and I think we'll have to raise the tax, because there will be no more reserves. And I also think we need to publicly acknowledge that if we don't raise the tax this year, that is not saying that won't happen in the future. I would think it will have to happen. Personally, I think it will have to happen in the very near future. And I think if we at least acknowledge that, it would be best, so that we don't start from scratch with this same, you know, legitimate argument, but I think we don't want to have to just repeat it exactly as we did already. So those are my basic feelings. I'd be willing to vote a budget that used reserves and didn't use a tax, but knowing that we may have to deal with that tax soon.
What will be left in the reserves? I was just looking with this, if we took 200.
For a total of 7.
Yeah, because 500 is already in the budget.
Yeah, okay. All right, thank you.
Do you want to know what's left in reserves?
Yes.
Yeah.
I'm looking at, and I'm assuming most of this is coming out of the capital improvement reserve, because there's two, we have a stabilization funds with a couple of reserves, and then we have the capital improvement. The stabilization fund has 1.69 million, but those are just things of like legal reserve, insurance reserve, and unfunded pension liability and early retirement, and that's 1.69 million. Then you have capital reserves, which encompass 3 different years, for a total of $824,000. Now, that is after taking out the half a million that's currently in the budget. So if you just go by the 824, if we took another, as I said, I said 200,000, we're down to 624. I mean, there's no question. It's getting deep. I mean, you know, and I will say I completely concur with Julia. That if we, I know it's shocking, folks. Believe me, it's on tape. Thank God it's on tape. That, you know, we are, if we get through this budget with these cuts, which are substantial, I mean, I don't disagree. But I'm also having, you know, huge trouble with the tax increase. I think if the sheriff issue appears in 2 months, it's all bets are off on the table. I mean, in my opinion, for me, I agree with Julia. I think we have to look at that. It may be a hard time. And then next year and the year after, you know, who knows? With the way the things are going daily, it's crazy. So
because the sheriff may not be just
right. I mean,
if it doesn't work, it's not just.
Yeah, we
this
keep
year.
Hearing wonderful no, things, and I'm you know I'm out there saying good, go take you know state take it. But if the sheriff comes back at $1 million, we do have a problem. But I've always said I'd rather keep these two things separate. So
I would prefer to deal with the budget, and then if the sheriff comes, I will even agree that I'm not taking a no to taxes. I will discuss the tax with you, but I won't take that pledge either. I'd rather not take the taxes for the budget right now. I think we can get out of this box without the tax, and then we have to face the other issue. That's my opinion.
Well, I would like to see the taxes. I'd like to see us preserve our reserves, if you will. That's my direction. I think for future bonding efforts and for this long-term stability, I think we're dipping way too low into our reserves. And we can't stop talking about the sheriff's issue as if it's not part of this discussion. It's $1 million that we're liable for, and we're in deep trouble if it doesn't come through in a timely manner or at all. I mean, stranger things have happened on Beacon Hill. So I think the tax is inevitable, and I think that now is the time to do it. And I think there are some things that could be left on the board with that tax, and we could whatever cuts we make should be replenishing the reserve accounts instead of tapping into the meat and grater. It's as simple as that. So I can see some of these cuts, but I'd prefer to start out with our economic revenue stream made somewhat near whole again.
I'll just say again, I right now I can't support the increase in the tax. And if we can do this without increasing the tax, I could possibly go along with what you have suggested. If we have to face the sheriff's problem, then we could once again review this increase in this tax. But right now, I'm not in favor of it.
So can we go over the cuts? Is that what we...
Yeah.
So
yeah. It seems to me that if I'm reading the majority of the Finance Committee, we better start going on what cuts we can cut so that we do not have to raise the tax.
A little adjustment that I would like on the... next to the Fire Academy, we said 25. Now I'm so converted that maybe I would change that to 5, which I would even feel guilty about, and take 20 from the Arts Council, which I don't even want to face those people. But leaving 5 for them as a symbolic gesture that we do care about it. And then maybe the Chamber of Commerce, since they're, you know, feeling strongly about the tax, they might want to go back and pick up the 5 grand for the smart guide. This doesn't save anybody off the streets either.
You know, the only thing about I heard the Fire Academy loud and clear also, but I was swayed when Lee mentioned that they tested 25 people.
Oh,
and if you just took 10, if you charged people $10 for that day, I mean, I just, as you may know, I have a Coast Guard license to run a boat, we all had to get something called a transportation worker identification card, and it cost me $138. And I went up for the day. There's not even a test. It's just that everyone has to do it for Homeland Security. So $10 would have equaled $25,000. I'm swayed when they tell us that it costs $6,000 to send someone to Stowe, and they don't spend a dime to send them over to us. I mean, it seems like there's money we could be grabbing, you know. And I think we've got to aggressively get on that training wagon and
towns have got to make some adjustment here. I would think they would want to do that.
It's incredulous to me that this stuff is in union contracts, but it is. I mean,
it's out of
the town's hands in certain respects.
And what voter knows that?
Right. It's not
zero.
It's not that, but there is a significant savings in overtime and transportation costs and housing costs. I think were the three mentioned, and that makes a lot of sense to me that we could be doing more with that. But I guess being from the private sector, I don't understand why all expenses are paid. Your expenses weren't paid in getting your Homeland Security certificate. But because of negotiations of boards of selectmen past and present, those fees are paid for by the town, so so be it. But at least we can save them the transportation costs if we stay local, and that should be a significant amount of savings. And maybe that $25,000 isn't the worst thing that's happened. I'd like to know more about the $74,000 for the that was not as clear as it should have been, I guess, in the Health and Human Services, the Health Department's budget.
Well, I just know a little bit about it from being on the Natural Resources Committee in the past. There are these alternative energy, alternative septic systems, but of course nobody really knows if they're working up to the level that we would like them to work. So George has got a very long-term study and collecting the data on this, and we've funded that study in the past.
If I could add something to that.
Yeah, oh, that's right. The grant ran out. Yeah.
The grant ran out. It was a grant, and it ran out, and we've been doing it, and the study is to try to get a fee-based system. So I think, and they're saying, 2010, they were hoping to be on a fee-based system that for these for this. So I think this is a gap funding they're looking for.
So if we don't fund it and we just take it out of there, then the whole thing falls in.
Well, that's what they say they may lose the person and have to rebuild the whole thing all over again. Yeah, that's what they're saying. Yeah.
That's a very serious cut.
It's all serious.
I know it. And I go back to the fact that this may be not to be the time to delay the tax that we've never raised in 20 years.
That's serious.
You can just call me 1-4.
Well, may I ask John, I mean, you've given up the 2.5. Remember, you were arguing about the 2.5.
Yeah.
I mean, we were already, like, past that.
Yeah.
Everybody's agreed.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like, that's automatically being raised.
Okay.
Because I don't, because you haven't allowed to show that, and I think all of us were like, that's 60,000, move on.
So I've moved on from that.
We're talking to Dean.
Marketing guy in me doesn't like it.
One of this quarter person in the quarter person in the commissioner's office, what is that you're suggesting?
That was an administrator in the commissioner's office.
That's an administrator, I believe, in the commissioner's office that was doing work for the Cape Light Compact.
Yes.
And for the first time, they shifted 3/4 of their time. So basically what he's saying is that they're going from a full-time to 3/4 time.
Yes.
I think that's really what that is,
yes. Okay.
My understanding.
All right. Okay.
I guess for years they've always been doing Cape Light Compact stuff, and they've never charged it.
Yeah,
so.
Okay. All right, thank you.
So it was shifting the last quarter to the Cape Light Compact?
No, it was shifting 3/4 to the Cape Light Compact. Then we're deleting the 1/4 that would be left in the commissioner's office. It was it's a full-time person,
right,
in the commissioner's office that has always, I guess, done 1/2 to 3/4 work for the Cape Light Compact. In the past, they've never charged it. This is the first year they've charged, and I guess this person does 3/4 of their time, actually does Cape Light Compact work. So it should have been done in the past, but it hasn't. So this year, they're charging it, and then they're leaving 1/4 in the commissioner's office. I guess what we're saying is we're going to cut their hours from full-time to 3/4 time.
Okay. So that is that. Yeah, not much, but it is the only staff cut that we're recommending.
That's correct.
Should this go through?
That's correct. I believe that, yes.
Another question, if I may, on the 68 for the economic development. Where's the 25?
The 25 is...
That is license plate money.
It's license plate money that we have ordered spent,
right,
at the rest area.
Right.
Now we're saying we wouldn't order that spent,
right,
but we would take 68 out of the license plate money for the personnel instead of paying for it out of the county budget.
They get the 25. They retain the 25.
Well, they.
That's correct. They would retain the 20.
They would retain the 25.
Now they could give a grant to someone to do that work out of the license plate money. That would be up to the. We wouldn't be directing the spending of that 25. Yeah. Yarmouth could petition for it. I mean,
there may be a clarification coming from our county administrator.
I just want, it's not, well, the actual amount is 34,576.
Could you use the microphone, Mark, please?
Oh, that's right, 34.
Just to clarify on that particular point, the actual amount is $34,576. That includes a halftime person and all the supplies and materials to clean the rest area on Route 6. It's actually in Yarmouth. And maintain that rest area, especially the bathrooms is what we're really talking about. From, I think it's the second week in May through Columbus Day. And we've been doing that for a number of years. We kind of got stuck with it. And that means that that's likely to close. Right? That's what will happen. We'll, if we divert that money out, then we can ask the state to pick it up. But that's why we got stuck with it in the first place, because the state didn't want to do it. So it's very likely that that rest area would close because of that.
Am I right in thinking, Mark, that if we said that all 35 is coming out of license plate, no, not 25?
No, that's correct. 34, oh, 576, okay. Yep.
Well, again, it seems to me that we could take it out of our budget, but it would be still available in license plate money, and Yarmouth, the Cape Cod Chamber, various entities could request that money in a grant if it's an important option, operation, which I think it is.
Well, I think it's an important operation, but in the long run, it isn't Yarmouth's, it's the state. The state owns that piece of that property. And, you know, I mean, sticking up for my town, I know that Yarmouth doesn't have any money to support that.
It seems to me that it's not Yarmouth's obligation to support
no.
that,
no,
nor is it the county's.
Nor is the chamber, nor the no. county.
Who,
it belongs
who gets
to the
benefit out of that? And, you know, who gets the benefit out of that, and who should pay for it? It either is, to me, the state or one of the chambers
Yarmouth
of commerce.
Yarmouth doesn't get any benefit out of it. They have a chamber of commerce booth there, but it's for distribution of information for all the towns on the campus.
And we're just giving the authority to spend that money back to the EDIC. I mean, we're not telling them what to do with the money. They can well spend it again. And they can hire it out privately if they want. But it does free up a one-half position plus benefits for our facilities department to do their job in a more meaningful manner. And I guess where the rubber meets the road is that they actually have to send two people out there because no one will dare go out there by themselves. So you can allocate that, but when you're running a facilities department, you're actually sending two of your valuable employees out there, travel time included, although not paid at overtime, I'm sure. But you're sending two people out there at a time to do a job that essentially isn't ours to do. And if the EDIC in their good judgment wants to restore those funds, they're very welcome to do that. And perhaps they could find a private contractor that could do it for less.
It's their responsibility either. I sense the state's. So let's send it back to the governor.
Moving through your list, are we at the Fire Academy now, or have we? I was very moved by what the Fire Academy did. I still think, and I agree with you on a long-term basis, or I may have been the lead dog in this in the past, that I would endeavor to have the fire academy move in the direction of becoming autonomous and funding itself, and I think that that's the direction we should be pushing them in. If $25,000 is a significant shove, I hate to say it, but I suppose I could support that right now, even in the face of the powerful testimony today.
Since I was willing to support 250 out of the reserves, I'd go for eliminating the 25 so that the fire academy is made whole, and go to 225 on the reserves. But that would just be my preference. But go. Why don't we go down the rest of the list from there?
What about the 20 arts?
You know, I thought when the chairs presented their case, they wanted to add money to the arts. So, and
they wanted to. I'm only picking on them.
It was rejected.
I mean, I was only picking on them
because it's not a county employee program. It's a outside program, supported by the county, which I do feel is good to do. But I don't have a strong view on it that we have to morally, one way or the other, you know.
Any grant and the forestry grant.
Where's poor Bill?
What is the mini grant?
Activities for different communities can apply for funds that you could run some library program after school.
The after school program?
It's similar to that, but not exactly that.
That's been scratched so many times.
And the other is, clearing
the forest, yeah. Which is.
Well, we're going to feel bad when the big fire comes from the uncleared forest. That's going to be bad.
I mean, Marsha, particularly with the forestry grant, with the career opportunities money, the JTEC money, would that be the sort of thing that at least for 10 weeks they could apply for crews, supervised crews, who could do that sort of work in various towns?
I don't know, but that's an excellent that's an excellent question. I should look into to see
there's training monies that are coming down that public agencies and nonprofits and others can take advantage of, and apparently it's quite a bit of money where they'll provide both the it's for 16 to 21 I think
16 to 21.
And they'll pay $8 to $10 an hour and provide a supervisor. And it's part of the stimulus package. Money's coming to, through JTEC. So any of you that have these sorts of opportunities, I know a lot of towns and schools are going to try to take advantage of that to do litter cleanup and cleaning of parks and brush and things like that.
Also, I will say another thing is that there was just a large amount of money given to AmeriCorps through the stimulus. I think it was $5 billion, if I remember correctly, just in the last day or so. It's just signed off. And actually, I was talking to some RDO people today, and I think they put in a grant. Oh, because you told me how much. I think it was for a good couple of $100,000. I don't know if the commissioners even knew that. But I know RDO has put in for, it's over $100,000, maybe it's $175,000, because there is new monies for AmeriCorps being funded through stimulus. So I don't know if that maybe could help. Right. Did some of this, because that's all work that they give back to the community. So that's just another, alternative that maybe we can, talk about. But we're still dealing with cuts here anyway, so.
Okay.
The next is the regionalization. Those cuts all come up to $609,000. Reserves would be $200,000 unless I prevailed on my $225,000 and we made the fire academy whole. That would be $809,000, and it's estimated that $813,000 is what the tax would provide. And the only thing we wouldn't be funding out of the list that the commissioners gave for what they were going to fund the $813,000, because there's a trade-off here. That $813,000 had everything from healthcare benefits, retiree benefits, Meals on Wheels, and a couple of others, and the regionalization. The only one we're not funding is the regionalization. So those others get funded by it, and the list that we have are the operational losers, if you will.
813. We got the five. How about the smart guy?
Don't have a copy.
Which list would you like? I have it.
814.
The 813,000?
Oh, she might not have it.
I don't have a list.
Okay, hang on.
You don't have a mic either.
I think we're all quite moved by the fire. See what happens when you turn out numbers and uniforms?
I've got a question on the arts, and I'm not sure of this, but maybe some of this more in tune. What is the entire budget for the Arts Foundation?
I know.
What?
I know.
Please.
Yes.
I know they have $900,000.
I know because I'm a member of their board. Their budget up until 2 weeks ago for the year was approximately $960,000, and they just voted 10 days ago to reduce it to approximately $620 because of the loss of grants, revenues, donations, contributions, all of that. So it's now down to about a little over $600,000.
They've taken a $300,000 hit.
That's
on their
right.
Budget?
Mm-hmm. And advertising for the POPs, all of that, everything has slid downward.
I'd like to bring up two more things, one small and one grand. The police training, they were getting $50,000 from us, and they were getting $25,000. I'm not sure what $5,000 worth of training is going to do for them if we're looking for $5,000 somewhere. There's $5,000 in police training in that. Okay, that's one. Stimulus package things are flying around the communities so quickly. I was given to understand that there may be significant money coming in from the feds for Meals on Wheels. And if that's the case, and they have such a tremendous budget, maybe we could look at that to balance some of our cuts. But I don't have any details. Like I said, some of this is just flying around so fast, I just don't know the answer to that. But Meals on Wheels could be put into the mix as far as on the cut table and adjust other things as well, as long as we're going through painful cuts.
Meals on Wheels is 75.
I didn't hear a rousing endorsement of your Meals on Wheels.
I know.
Cut.
Feeding elderly people in their homes. But if they have the ability to get the money elsewhere.
It's a very significant program that you know deals with the most vulnerable of our elderly and low income folks, and I think it's been, you know, a credit to the county that they've supported it, you know, for so long. And I know Elder Services is under a lot of strain, you know, with that. But one thing I would like, if you took the police training and added that 5,000 in, you're up to 814,000. So we've actually covered the increase for the human. Practically covered the increase of the Human Rights Commission too. I'd also, as long as we're looking at amendments, I'd also want to consider an amendment that delayed any capital improvements and gave us the choice at the end of the year, or the commissioners a choice at the end of the year, if they chose to submit a supplemental budget to restore any of these cuts that they suddenly wanted to do something with wastewater or you know, the mini-grant program toward the end of something, you know, that they could do that. Without that sort of guidance, I think they'd move forward with the capital improvements. And if they got more revenues than they needed, I'd just as soon delay the capital stuff. So.
Feel I know enough about that. It's hard to judge. Are these, you know, are we talking ceilings fall down without them, or are we talking it would be nice? I can't make that judgment without knowing more.
So you just assume leave it in?
Well, I'd
leave it be.
I'd need more before I'd be sure I wanted to direct them not to do it. We could maybe learn more, maybe we could, but it doesn't save out of the, it's the payments, we know there's going to be payments on the money already spent, right? So, and cutting it doesn't really free up money in the basic account, that's what I gathered. Oh well. Do we want to consider any increases to the budget?
No.
No.
I don't see how we can't come up with enough funding. I don't see that we can.
I'm just
that we can talk about increases.
So, does that include the Human Rights Commission $1,500?
I would go with that.
You would vote for that?
I would vote for that.
I would choose.
Because I know they really are hurting for that, that they didn't even have the money to run the programs.
I mean, for those assembly members who are...
That's the thing that holds me back, is the fact that they're not a department. We have cut all the departments.
Well, we've cut them. It's just that that's a bigger cut than they feel they can stand. They were still getting a cut, as I understood it. She was asking for some of the cut back.
If you're looking to increase, I'm looking at your list, and with the $5,000 added for police training, if that's what you decide to do, you come to $814,000. As you know, the commissioner's projection for the sheet that we all have for the projection of the tax increase was, the estimated yield was $813,000. So my suggestion is, if you're going to increase the budget with what you have suggested for cuts right now, you have $1,000. Okay.
Just for information for those assembly members who weren't at the Finance Committee meeting but are listening, that, you know, we put a whole host of cuts forward. For instance, if you were to look to the employees and say, look, maybe you'd consider a furlough of 1 week a year, which comes out to really, if you did 40 hours, that would be 1 hour, you know, a week for 40 weeks that you wouldn't get paid for if you spread it out that way. That came out to $130,000. If you were to look into personnel cuts, there are two, for the first time in the registry, we're funding two positions out of this county budget. So we are using county revenues to do that. That's $90,000. If you looked just as an average salary of $45,000 to $50,000, that's what it would be if you chose to cut, you know, other personnel. If you looked into, you know, a different mix outside of the 75-25 present employee contribution to the medical insurance and went to 70-30, each 5% cut represents $96,000. We didn't look at reduction in hours for personnel. in some communities, you're offering to individuals, your workforce, saying, you know, are there folks who would be willing to work 20 hours instead of the 40, and what do you have for savings there? We didn't go into that because we just weren't touching the personnel stuff. And I would say also that I was willing to offer an amendment that would have, since employees are taking a COLA hit and a step hit, offer to reduce the assembly stipend to $500 from $1,000 and to reduce the county commissioner's salary by $1,500 each. Those were viewed to be off the table by...
That we could cut our salary by half or whatever, and that I could support that. There's some very elaborate situation of cutting the commissioner's salary, which has to be in some very narrow window of time, and now is not it. But we could do ourselves. We just, you can see, we wouldn't be allowed to punish them, or, you know, that wouldn't be allowed. So I would support our taking a cut.
And that would be $7,500.
But we have a more serious problem.
We have a more serious problem. Ugh. All Martian. My college education, and I'm off $100,000 on the adding. I asked somebody to check my adding. Yeah, on that sheet that I just handed you out.
It's only $709.
It's $709, yeah. Yeah, between regionalization and reserves, I added an extra $100,000. I knew it wasn't working. So I beg, I throw myself on the mercy of the court. So we're at 709 on that sheet that I handed out.
Right.
Yeah.
You need $400,000.
Right.
Just weren't cutting it.
Yeah.
It
should be 359. Right, that should be 359, regionalization, and then that goes, it becomes 509, and if you add reserves, it's 709.
Okay, so. All right, now we've got the police for $5. We could. Yeah, we could do the smart guide for $5. We could do this. I mean, we could do.
I think we should do the smart guide when the Chamber of Commerce. I mean, honestly, on principle, the Chamber of Commerce came here, voted against the tax. They want to vote against the tax. We should. We took this on. I don't know how many years ago, as a favor to them. I mean, I think most of us are all here for that. I think it's minor as it is, but it's a pushback. You know, they don't want to vote for the tax. Fine, but then. Fine, you got to take this back. So I think the $5,000 for the smart guide should be gone.
And then we could put down the $7,500 from the assembly. We could at least write it down. Yeah, that doesn't quite get up to $100. Yeah, I put that down.
To 17.
May I say something?
And I'm speaking as an individual. I'm not speaking for the county commissioners. This afternoon, we had this outpouring of emotion from the real estate people, the representatives from the real estate, and it was enough to break anyone's heart, because I think the only people who sell homes now on Cape Cod are old people who are in dire straits. At a time when this was, when the boom was on, the housing prices went so high that people who were born here and have lived here all their lives could no longer live here. And there was no empathy or concern coming here to this table from those people or anybody in that association. And because the Cape Cod Chamber has a funding stream that was originally put together to come to the county funds. There is $400,000 they get of public money to a private organization. And when we had our license plate money, that annual thing, they came to us, give us this $100,000, it will go to the, now we saw the sense in it, we thought it was a goodwill thing to do, we gave that to Coastal Capital. So we're going to punish them by making them take back $5,000. It's a pushback. This type of reasoning just doesn't make sense to me, and this is our county government. We are all part of that county government. And this is 1 year where we have put forth, we are in very strange and unprecedented times. And you have two new county commissioners who had to deal with the budget with how they, within weeks, a very short period of time, and I thought we did very due diligence to this. With the promise that we are having an operational audit, we are going to go deep into our own functions by July of this year and have everything looked at, and we have said, give us this year, and we will have a budget that we are totally responsible for, and it will be a different functioning government that we feel will be more professional and more relevant to the lives of those living on Cape Cod. And to be going into these conversations about we're going to do, you know, over, when I hear this with the Chamber of Commerce, and now we're upset about this tax that is a one-time tax for most people in their lives, and it's going to be absorbed into the cost and the transaction of that transfer of that property, whatever it may be. We are having such difficulty in doing that when it has never been done. It's just, as a private citizen, as a private person, not as a commissioner, I just think it's an amazing conversation.
I don't mean to be heartless, but I am not opposed or not willing to vote for a budget without the tax, because anything said here about the suffering of real estate is that's not what's motivating me at all. It's not that I'm not sympathetic to them, but that is not influencing my thinking. My thinking is influenced by the fact that I think you did do a nice job of the budget in a short period of time, but I am worried about the long-term effect of what may happen next year and the next year and the next year. I can anticipate that things are not going to improve quickly, and I am pretty sure we're going to need a tax increase, but I would like to put us in a position to be as narrow and down as we possibly can before we do that, and particularly this year when we have to deal with the sheriff money. I cannot go again. I vowed last year that I couldn't go another year or two or three. If it doesn't pass now, it's not going to pass next year or the year after. I mean, it's, and I cannot face a budget that doesn't allow for another $1 million quick for the sheriff. That's my problem.
If it doesn't happen this year, it will never be able to be happening again. And I understand that.
That's my serious fear, and I am not willing to vote a budget
that
doesn't recognize that.
This is a board of commissioners who aren't just going to, once this is over, this process, not to pick it up again until, you know, January of next year. This is going to be our job from here until then. I'm just saying, nobody is more concerned than we are, because, you know, it's our job right now to keep this county functioning, and we're looking to you for that help. So that's all I wanted to say.
You know, I think we're being reasonable with this. I think the county functions very well even with these cuts. And just to build your budget on new revenues without taking these actions, you know, I think is a disservice to the process, and I think that we need to look very hard at the budget now. And I'm comfortable with these. I am worried about the next $80,000 we have to come up with.
Please, Fred.
I can talk from here. You know, I'm sorry I missed the public portion of this, and I certainly am sorry I missed the realtor portion of this. I wrote a letter to the CEO of the Cape and Islands Association, where I said that I'm an active realtor on Cape Cod, as well as the Turo's delegate to the county assembly. And I've asked that he publish my letter to the all of the realtors on Cape Cod in opposition to their position, to the position of the board, I assume. It was not identified. And I said to him, the lack of information given to realtors about this issue is completely irresponsible. The flyer that went around, which I have a copy of it, says, Cape and Islands opposition to proposed increase to deeds excise tax, March 2009, Dear Frederick, in an attempt to balance Barnstable County's budget, a deeds excise tax increase of 43 cents per thousand has been proposed. We realtors, as realtors, we are strongly opposed to this tax increase, as it is a discriminatory case which will be borne by sellers at the time when they have already been hard hit by declining values and loss of equity. There's no mention whatsoever of what Barnstable County does, what this money is for, what the circumstances, no context whatsoever. There was also no attempt to poll realtors to find out what realtors think about the deeds excise tax. So this is coming from some group at the Cape and Islands Real Estate Group. Now, I talked to about 20 realtors in the last 3 or 4 days and asked them what they thought about this. None of them had heard about it, and they hadn't read this that was sent to them, because they're kind of busy trying to find some sales. But I went on to try to explain what the county does. And one of the things that I wanted to point out was to him, perhaps you've heard and read about the next most important effort by local Cape governments is to regionalize their services, share resources, departments, equipment, supervisors in order to cut cost. In fact, state grants are given out to support that. Well, Barnstable County is the Cape's existing regional services provider. And I go on to a long reason of why the Cape is so—it's so important for the Cape to have regional services based on its geography and what services are being offered. Also, went on to say that in fact this budget with this deeds tax still was cut 8%, and last year was cut as well, and that this tax increase on a $300,000 home is $129. I can't imagine that's enough to really have any meaningful impact on any real estate sale in this county. I understand that the Cape and Islands Association of Realtors and their political base has always been anti-government, except when they would like government to be on their side. They're against big government. This is a group that has supported I hate to bring up political parties, Republicans and George W. Bush in all of the years that he was running for office. It's along with the Chamber of Commerce. I mean, why is the Chamber of Commerce a make or break situation here, as opposed to the people of Cape Cod, not the businesses that we are supposed to be representing? This 15 people in this group, we're representing the people of Cape Cod. I believe that the people of Cape Cod are served by county government, Barnstable County government. I think that's the most important aspect of what we have to do. You know, the Chamber of Commerce is always against big government. They were against, both of these organizations were against the land bank, and they fought it and fought it, and finally it passed, and then the Community Preservation Act came in. I'm sure they wouldn't want to look back and say what a big mistake that was to have been against the land bank. The Chamber of Commerce has historically been against any form of the Clean Water Act, the Clean Air Act. They were totally against. And I think, you know, we really have to take the responsibility as representatives to look at the people of the county, the children, families of the county, people that our services have been designed for and are specifically designed for. And we also know that the county commissioners could have, this raise could have been to $1.14. They looked through the budget, cut what they could without cutting jobs, and brought it down to 43 cents. And this is the first increase, I think, that's ever been made. So I think those are areas that are very important to tell the people of the county about what is being tried here. The county is one of the best things that is going. The county government is one of the most important, vital areas. Its budget is that of a very small town on Cape Cod, and yet it supports hundreds and thousands of activities across the Cape, transportation for the whole Cape, and so on and so forth, and regional planning. I just think that, you know, cutting county government is a big mistake, and I don't think we should be a part of it. And I think we should look for to try and trim things that we think are bad programs, but to cut programs that you sit and say, I think this is a good program, it's certainly vital to the community, but we have to make a cut in it, I think is a mistake.
Thank you, Fred. Back to the committee.
I still say that, Fred, that you can't assume that people who don't want the tax are entirely doing it because the Chamber of Commerce has a particular point of view. So that would be my only quibble with that. To avoid the tax, we still don't have enough cuts quite, or we could increase what we took from the reserves. I'm counting 32% of the vote that have said they are opposed to the tax increase. That's Marcia, the two Toms, Charlotte, and probably Tony Scalise. That comes to 32%. 27 and 40. Oh no, I'm missing. All right, what I'm 11 is 20, 45. 45. 42, is
it? Do we have a finance committee that can't add?
Well, you do.
Have we exposed ourselves here today?
I mean, I've been doing it on my fingers. Okay. It's 5. I'm bringing this up now because I've said all along I'm most interested in getting something that the assembly, the most people in the assembly, can feel good about. All right. So we've got no tax at the moment. If Charlotte is sure here, we've got 52% of the people who won't vote for a budget that includes a tax increase. That doesn't include me, but that's what I'm hearing, that we have 52% that are opposed to a tax. So I don't know how Dick feels. I don't know how Paul, Teresa, Chris, I think I know how Fred, Ron, John, Leo, I'm not sure. Okay. But we don't have a 50% for a budget that includes a tax. At the moment, we do not have that. So that's the first reality that we have to deal with. So then, unless people really want to lobby hard on Marcia, Tom, Charlotte, and Tony, we don't have a budget that includes a tax increase. Right? Am I right?
I would say that right now those numbers sound fairly solid to me. I'm not sure that that's the end game, because we've gone down that road before.
Right.
But that being said, then once all of these $813,000 worth of cuts or dips into the reserves might change some minds. I don't know. But when people have to go back to the constituents and say, we're cutting the Fire Academy $25,000, when we're cutting regionalization money was very well received in Dennis. I don't know what I'm going to hear from my constituents when I go back and say,
I'm assuming you're willing to vote for the tax.
I am.
I'm only talking about Marcia,
I'm willing to cut,
Tom,
and I'm willing
Tom
to preserve our reserves. I don't think that's been then that's been talked about enough. We're cutting our reserves below the bone, and we don't have any guarantees of a timetable or a finality to the fact that we are not going to be responsible for $1 million worth of sheriff's health retirement benefits.
You mean even Marcia says that we're going to have to go with the tax if we lose the sheriff problem?
I say now is the time, and then also our fiscal responsibility is to not take those reserves and spend them right now. I think it's going to affect our bond rating. I think there's lots of ancillary things that will happen.
You know, something we're doing here is we're allowing the commissioners to manage their own budget. We could put a hiring freeze in effect in this budget. And based on the attrition that'll probably come through the county, there's going to be savings there. I mean, Mark could probably give us an average on, they had 7 vacant positions now. I don't know how many of those folks left, but if they lost 4 people, that could be a savings of 150, 200,000. That could be used to replace the reserves if you wanted to do that. The commissioners could do their own hiring freeze if they wanted. They have ways within the budget to manage this money to, you know, still come through whole without, you know, without the tax increase. But, you know, I don't think this is a crippling process that we're asking. But so, I mean, as I say, you could suggest a furlough. There's $130,000. I mean,
Mr. Speaker,
you know, every political organization is different. In Chatham, we dipped into what we called stabilization of reserves, but each item had to be justified as a one-time unrecurring expense. That's how basically we do it. The concept of building the operating budget on reserves, in other words, of not having as much income as outgo, is something that must be unique to Barnstable County, as far as I know, because I don't know of any other organization that uses money for the operating, uses reserves for operating expenses. Usually it's used for, you know, something breaks, you know, or Mark comes and something special happens and they have to, one-time expense, and it goes into, so that's one issue. Another issue, and I don't want to follow up too much on what Fred says, but I've just gone through the budget process in Chatham, and, you know, we use the same words. We use, oh, there's got to be a savings, or we got to tighten our belt, we got to cut this, we got that. But if you really boil it down to what it comes, somebody, if there is a deficit, somebody is going to have to pay that. If you don't raise your revenues and you lower the expenses, those expenses are going to come out of somebody's, some person is going to have to pay it. So really what you're making decision is between who's the deserving and who's the undeserving. You're saying these people can't afford to take a cut, but these people can. What you're saying is we don't want to take the money out of the real estate market, but we're willing to ask the employees to take a furlough, which would cost them $130,000. Now, you know, so you're really making a choice between who is going to pay for this. You know, I think you should keep that in mind when you look at the budget, because somebody down the line for all of those cuts is going to come out of somebody's pocket. You know, and that's unavoidable. The question is, who feels the least pain and who would feel the most pain? You've heard from people like Alan Burt about people who might take pain. And you know, we've told him and his friends that they're off the table. But, you know, we have to show a little backbone, I think, in trying to protect some of the county's functions. And if we don't, then we have to be honest and say, you know, the rest station is going to close. And if you're driving here from, you know, from Ohio and you need to use a bathroom, you're just out of luck. You know, I mean, you have to face those realities and what's behind these numbers and not just think of them as numbers. So that's my little speech for the day.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chairman? Yeah. Specifically on the tax, when the assembly was first created 20 years ago by the charter, we were allowed a certain tax or less. The assembly voted to take the top amount at that time. There were several of us who wanted to take something less because the expenses at that time were not as great. Of course, as the Pocasset Hospital started to founder, we needed the money, but we didn't need it at first. I was one of those who voted against the highest amount of the tax, and so was Luke Poyant, who represented Barnstable, but we were a minority. So the full tax was chosen, and as we look back over 20 years, I think it was probably a pretty good idea, and I'm in favor of voting in this. Voting on this tax is a higher amount. By the way, Mark mentioned that the rest area is in Yarmouth. It's in Barnstable.
Actually, George, the property is, the largest portion of the property is behind that area, is Yarmouth.
The late Joan Condit used to get very excited when anyone said it was in Barnstable.
I wish it were in Barnstable.
The board? The board seems to be doing numbers. Does anybody else from the assembly want to comment? Good? That's what I've got 717, so I'm missing another 9. Oh, right.
Assembly
of
delegates.
I think I did.
You've
no, I don't.
5,000 for the police.
Right.
5,000 for the smart guy. And $7,500 from the assembly of delegates.
Okay.
I believe that comes to 726,000.
Yeah, and that's without the
$500.
That's not, got it,
so
gotcha.
$87,000 short.
726,500.
Shall we all write a check?
So if we're still going in the direction of cuts, we're at 726.5, I've been informed, including the assembly and the police and the smart guide. That still leaves a structural deficit of about 86 grand.
I know we can take more from the reserves, but... So we're already taking 500, and now we're talking about
87.
No. Now we're already taking 900. This would be 900 from the reserve. So, you know, that's why I've said I could vote a tax increase, because my interest is less in whether we have a tax increase or not. It's more in what's a sound budget, and I can't find that a 900 out of the reserves is a great idea. I can't feel, oh my gosh, what a great budget, you know. Even with all these cuts, we'd still be taking 900,000 out of the reserves. That nobody could, fiscal conservative people couldn't feel good about that. On the other hand, there's drawbacks to the tax. So I'm just seeking 67% of this assembly to come up with something. And I don't know how some people feel. I'm willing to go either way if it would make a good vote. But we can't feel proud of either way. We just don't have enough money, and we don't have too much spending. That doesn't work.
I have somebody over here. Mr. Keyes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Did you put an amount in this deliberation on capital items, deferring capital to the end of the year?
Yeah, because it's a wash.
What's that amount?
It's a wash. It's all done by bonding, and so you put it in expenses and in revenue from the bonding, and so it's equal. We can cancel the expense, but we then cancel the revenue in our budget. So cutting it doesn't get us any more money in the general fund.
I think there's a little wiggle room there, though. I think you need to take another look at that. I think there's a little bit of wiggle room there, and I think that might get you to that balance that you're looking for.
Well, there's possibly the bonding payments, which we don't have exact figures on. But that would be for the old things we've already spent the money on, and not adding new ones, and we don't know the answer on that.
With you, we just 66.84. So we just make it.
I
I think it would add new as well. I believe the amount in the budget, correct me if I'm wrong, Mark, and it's on page 17 of the budget ordinance, which is the very last page, the page that you received that, from email from the office, this document, the ordinance. It's where we add all the technical information, and the amount in the FY 210 budget proposed to be bonded, and this came from the treasurer, this amount is $225,000. And I think that includes whatever's left over for bonding from a previous year, and then takes into consideration the 235 or whatever it is for 010. Am I correct, Mark?
I haven't seen the ordinance yet, so I don't know that. No, it sounds like you're not, because the 010 is 235 itself.
Well, this amount, that's the amount that Joanne gave me.
I'd have to look. I don't know. I know this year, the bond expenditure is over $1 million. We had over $1 million in the budget for bonds this year, because we were doing quite a bit of stuff.
So it doesn't sound 50. And didn't you indicate, Mark, that they're retiring? You're retiring some on July 1st.
All the outstanding bond issues yet is all the bond. We've spent it all on.
But 2009, we have never issued bonds for. But we will need to between the time we spend it and 2 years from now.
So are you carrying money for the bond indebtedness?
In the 2010 budget, yes.
And how much is that?
I think it's
$175,000. So you're assuming that $175,000 would carry $225,000 or whatever the other numbers that you wanted, whatever.
What's this year's debt and the proposed 2010?
And how much is in this year's debt?
It's over $1,074,000.
We have to have something to pay the $1 million debt. It has to be in this year's budget.
You know, some of it, depending on what you're doing, this is why I can't answer the question directly. Some of it might be issued on a 10-year note. Some of it might be issued on a 20-year note. But we have to sit down and look at what's all in that. Like, I think the phone system we would want to do is a 20-year note, because maybe paying it off while we just buy a new one. So we'd probably do that as a 10-year note. So I have to kind of look at what you're doing and what's a 20-year project, what's a 10-year project.
If we delayed any capital improvements for a year, would there be $70,000 saved from your bond indebtedness that would get us to our goal of $813,000?
And that's why I can't say. I don't know how much you would save out of the $175,000. I don't know.
I'm not going to be interested. You know, they've got 52 to pass that, but it's not veto proof, obviously. So that's less desirable. And I'm talking to Dick as he's leaving. I don't know how you're feeling about the tax, and so if you would support a veto of the budget passed by the 52% that I can see now, you see, that could be a problem. I mean, we really are going to have to think about this, and... Think about it.
I was going to say, okay, right now, then how does the committee feel about the two positions at the registry? For the first time, we are funding two positions at the registry. That's $90,000.
And what can they be doing?
What we're discussing right now is the $90,000 in registry. Now, do we have to be specific about cutting that, or can we just cut $90,000 and let them do what they will? You know, stop paying for paperclips. I don't know what they're going to do. Yeah, we cut the money and let them do what they will. I'm doing this philosophically to move this along, not that I'm going to vote for it at all. But is that the committee's desire to look at this? Do you want to match it up to exactly the amount? Do you want to start pushing back on some of the other stuff that you don't want and make it an even 90 grand coming out of there and make them... That probably would be helpful.
I will. 90,000 for the wastewater, right? 74,000 for the health and environmental study. 4,000 for the COLA. 20,000 for the quarter person. 68,000 for the EDC. We're doing 25 at the moment for the fire. 25 for the mini grant, 17 for the other grant. We need 5 for the police, 5 for the fire, 5 for the
assembly.
75
for the
assembly. 75 for the assembly. And then we have 90,000. What do you call it, Charlotte?
I come 726 by with all of those, but then we're 87,000 short if we're going for 813.
Okay, I know,
but I mean, I'll still
decide. 25 for the fire,
25 and 17, I always forget which is which. One's a mini one. 25 and 17 is a mini, and I always forget who's who.
Okay, so at this point, we're 359.
Okay. 150 for the regionalization office.
Right, so that's five on that.
Two, so many people. 200 for reserves. Five for the police academy, police training, five for the arts, and five for the
smart guy. Did you take five for the arts?
Yes. Five for the police, five for arts, and five for smart.
Well, what about the 75?
And the next 75 for the assembly.
We vote 52-48 and not vote.
We can give it back, we're over. And then 90,000 for the registry. I get 821,500. I'm sorry. Check your math. Check my math.
I don't know.
That's a good one.
I totally botched that.
What's the good item?
Where do you get, Charlotte?
821,500.
That's it. Okay. So we can give, we'll try to get 813.
And we only need
813. Right? So, and so we have 8,500 extra. And since, and you know something, since the fire is so big, I can take it back for the fire. So drop the fire down by 8,500 and write
813.
So we dropped it.
We only needed 87,000.
Oh, okay. Well, I was going to
say.
Well, I was going to say, if we make the fire 16.5 instead, that would give us 830. Okay. Should I tell you? Okay, gentlemen.
I'm going to wait. Yeah. We're going to do this. I want a motion.
Okay. Well, let me read what we have. We're trying to get to 813, right? And everybody's moved by the fire, so the fire's going to actually get a hit, but not as much. How about this?
Could you use the microphone, please?
Well, pardon?
Could you use the mic, please?
Yeah, absolutely.
90,000 for that wastewater discussion, 74,000 for the health and environmental study, 40,000 for the COLA for the full year, 20,000 for that quarter person in this commissioner's office, 68,000 for the EDIC, with the understanding about the 35,000 they can get back, fire 16.5. For the fire academy, 25 and 17. Remember, I have a problem with coming. One's the mini, one's the forestry, and I forget which is which. 150 for the regionalization office. 200 in additional reserves, with not a happy camper all the way around. Five for that police training. Five from the arts foundation. Five from the smart guide. 7,500 from the assembly. And 90,000 from the registry of deeds. And if all things are right, does that equal, that should equal 813.
813 even?
That's what I'm getting. But let's make sure that. Is that what you get? You okay?
Yeah, I don't know why. I just, I didn't expect a tilt.
I had 821,500, but that was.
That's with the 25 for the fire. We're decreasing the fire by that, by the difference. The fire is. Which I'm taking out, we're decreasing the fire from 25,000 to 16.5. Yeah, they're taking a hit, but not, way down from the 75 grand. No, it has to be done properly.
If you're going to vote this, what I'll do is go into the budget and give you all the specific detailed information that you need to refer to for your
But let's at least have a motion.
now, funds committee, this is what we're proposing.
And that we will, all five of us support?
Well, I'm not willing to vote for it, but I'm not.
Okay.
I might just abstain. I don't know, I mean.
Come on.
See, no, because I'm willing to vote a lot, most of the cuts, I'm not, yeah.
Oh, the assembly, so it's no before that.
Why don't you do two separate motions?
I was going to say, well.
But why would, if you do the cuts, why would you vote on the tax?
Because I don't, I would take back the $500 from reserves to the budget and then put in.
Okay, so, oh, I see, you said, you want to do the tax to cover.
I would be willing to do the tax.
Cover the $700,000.
To cover the reserves.
Which is basically $700,000 right now.
Yeah. That would be, I'm willing to pretty much go with the.
Go with the cuts, but you also, then, yeah, if you can separate that as a vote, you see what stands, yeah.
I hate to come back to reserves, but if you went to $250,000, you could save the grief of the Hans Foundation.
Yep.
Please, that you could knock out three or four of these things.
What's that, the country that's studying that, the continuity of the septic?
That's serious. See, that's why I would rather have gone to having the tax.
That study, though, it wasn't explained correctly, I was trying to describe it a little better. It's not necessarily a quote-unquote study, it's, he's putting together the fee and structure so that all of these alternative septic systems that are in place that are required to be monitored, a lot of the problems that the towns are having is that they're having problems with monitoring agents on these systems. So he's going to be able to actually monitor a lot of these systems through computers.
Who's he?
Excuse me, George Hoyfelter.
He can't do it during his regular day, is that it?
No, this is part of the test center work that they do. And obviously, they've done all the testing on the systems. This has got nothing to do with testings, whether testing.
He should be the fee on the agreement on the works as a zoning board of appeals, you know, or planning board approves the permit. And then when they do that permit, they assign a monitoring agent, and we're standing there as a council, and they do that monitoring agent, and they say, how much? And they say, $200 a month.
But that's for housing, is that for septic systems as well?
Well, that would be a major, most of your, you know, on-site septic treatment is for housing developments, having to go pay for a lot of commercial ones.
I just wanted to make it clear that it had nothing to do with the evaluation of the septic system. It was going to provide a system so that when, on a yearly basis, the contractor goes out and takes the test data as far as how the system's working, the county will be the recipient of that information and provide a service to the town. But evidently, the fee for service is between the homeowner and the contractor, and the county collects the fee. So in 2000, I mean, I'm not arguing for it. I'm just trying, I just want to make sure that you're not thinking it's worth the septic. I'm not arguing against it. But anyway, it's so that the county can collect a fee and collect the test information on a yearly basis from the contractors.
Okay, so they're going to collect the fee.
Right. Yeah, but wouldn't the information go to the town, like Board of Health or something? And then, I mean, I guess I'm finding this like odd. I mean, I'm not sure what we're doing and why is it costing $74,000 when a staff person is doing this already?
To set up the actual structure, and I'm the wrong person to be providing this technical information.
Yeah, I'm going to say it. Can you tell me, the homeowner and the contractor, you deal with him, then why are we involved? And maybe the information would go to the Board of Health of every town, and they kind of just say, hey, could you give us the information? I'm not sure why.
It's more complicated.
I'm sure it is.
I mean, we should be doing it.
Yeah.
We have to do it now, I don't know.
If you wanted to swap out one of those positions, I guess it's, you could increase reserves, but you have to get one position.
Don't disagree, I mean, absolutely.
I think we're at 8:13 with I think a general consensus. I mean, we may have added to some of this.
We could reconsider any of this, but we could take a vote on this. Yeah.
I mean,
do you want two votes? Do you want a vote on it?
I think it's best to do two votes.
Two votes?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I move that we remove the...
Do you want to say it into the microphone so we can know? This is important.
I move that we remove Section A of the ordinance regarding the increase in the excise tax and maintain it at its existing level.
I'll second the motion.
Is there more discussion on that? Hearing...
Section 1, Section A.
So I'll take a vote on removing... removing the tax from the county FY 2010 budget.
Who seconded that?
I did.
Charlotte. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? That passes 3-2. The removal of that passes 3-2. Regarding cutting taxes to balance the budget. Cutting the operational budget to balance the FY 2010 budget. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Well,
as I'll read them all over again.
Please do.
Okay.
I think we'll get some copies to everyone so that
mine's chicken. I'm assuming Diana's taking notes and she will put it in type and make it look a lot nicer then. $90,000 for the wastewater study to be done by the Cape Cod Commission. $74,000 for, that was the Health and Environmental Office was doing the work on the alternative sewerage. $40,000 for the COLAs to extend it from the 6 months to a full year. $20,000 for the quarter person in the commissioner's office, the county commissioner's office, $68,000 for the EDIC that the county was funding. The fire academy, $16,500. The mini grant, is that the $25,000? Okay, $25,000 for the mini grant, $17,000 for this forestry grant.
It's the other way.
Is it the other way? See, I have like a block on that. Thank you. Okay. $150,000 for the regionalization office. $200,000 be taken additionally out of reserves. $5,000 for the police training. $5,000 cut to the Arts Foundation. $5,000 deletion of the Smart Guide funding. $7,500 cut from the assembly. And $90,000 from the Registry of Deeds. And that totals $813,000, which is what we were told would be what the commissioners would cut. That's the motion to make those cuts on the floor for the budget.
In a discussion of that,
we need a second.
I'll second it.
In a brief discussion, I think all of us could assume that there could be, before we take the vote, and if we do have a meeting in 2 weeks, there could be some little modifications here. But in general, this is the type of situation where we realize might have to be cut.
Further discussion?
I don't think anyone is really thrilled with these. I think, you know, this is a Sophie's Choice type thing. This is not, usually palatable all the way around, but I feel that the tax as it is right now is small. I think that we have to do this before we can go to the electorate and the constituents to say that we have done everything. To me, with this, I could, in decent conscience, support if we have the problem with the sheriff. I think we need to do this to go back to the electorate that some of us were going to say, I can't believe you voted for a tax, to be able to say, we've done it. I don't want to cut any of these. I think all of these programs, we have done an incredible amount of great stuff in the last 10 years since I've been here. And this is disheartening. But I think this is a reasonable compromise, and I hope the commissioners will be able to deal with it, and we'll be able to get a decent budget. Thank you.
And should we have a problem as far as the sheriff is concerned?
Use the microphone, please.
I'm sorry. If we should have a problem as far as the sheriff is concerned, if it doesn't come through, then we have to face that. And I'll go on record that I will support, because we've made these cuts, I will support the tax increase to cover if necessary. If we have to come up with the money for the sheriff's retirement fund.
I'm in the minority here, but I just want to state once again that I think what we're forgetting about this is we're forgetting the lifestyle cuts that we're going to be taking if we cut all of these programmatic stuff that we've got, ongoing programs that have done so well for the people of Barnstable County. And some of that may reverberate right into the real estate market if we have no embayments that can sustain fishing and shell fishing grounds, and we do some of these things that just may have unintended consequences by stopping programs short that have been working so well. I think that we've had the same tax in place for 20 years, and adding $129 to a real estate sales tax at this time and keeping every dollar of it local to preserve these important things has to be considered, and when you go back to your constituents, they'll let you know, and I'm sure I'll hear from mine. So I support the cuts. I think every dollar we cut should go back into preserving our reserve funds, because we need those for our bond funding, and we need those for the future foundation of a successful Barnstable County.
But could I just add, I mean, I sound like the realtor that I used to be, but it's not only this $126, it's all of the other taxes, that the closings and all of those things that are also added on to that sum of money that makes it very difficult and expensive. So,
I think the problem is far beyond the last $127 that this would be charged. I mean, houses aren't selling now. That's not the tipping point. The point is that there's no banking money. There's extraneous forces well beyond the county's
but
purview.
John, what you know, if you raise it now, what do you do if the sheriff shows up? And that million, I mean, you can't go back to the well. I mean, I think
that's why we preserve, we keep the money out of all of the cuts can put back into reserves, so we have that money in reserves to pay for it. That's the financially sound way to look at this. We don't take $700,000 out of reserves.
Well, Are
you voting against this?
For purposes of discussion, right at this moment, I would be voting against.
Okay.
This.
Well, what about we propose this list that Marcia had? We amend her motion and we took out the reserve, and that was a separate vote.
Then it's not a balanced budget.
No, that's a separate vote. We voted 3-2 in favor of supporting the tax or removing the tax. We could have a vote on the cuts, and we then could have a third vote on taking the money out of the reserves.
Why don't we vote the 18 as is and see what
happens? Okay, all right. Just a thought.
Yeah, I just add, if we want to go down that route, I would have probably.
I don't think it matters.
No, but I might have wanted to vote on each of them because, and that may be what happens when we get to the full thing. You know, because I've stated before on the economic development, I'd rather not do that. The spirit of compromise, I'm swallowing hot on that.
I agree. We don't want a lot of amendments on the floor. I agree. But the reserves is a little different from the cuts. That's
going to establish
it. All right. Are we moving this? You moved this. Do we have a second? All right.
It's been moved and seconded, and we have
in the middle of our discussion. Yeah, okay.
Is there further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of $813,000 in tax cuts, as agreed upon in theory, on paper, right?
Aye.
And opposed, no. So it is 4-1 it passes that we will cut $813,000 out of the budget.
All right, now let's go back, Tom, to this previous point. Are you planning on
considering different cuts proposed individually on the floor before we go into the budget?
No, I would support the committee's action to on the 813, unless there was information between then that swapped some out and we all did it, I'll abide by the majority vote.
All right. Now, we need to establish a final meeting point to make sure that these cuts are viable and are without unintended consequences that make them not so. So how about on the 15th, which is the day we on the budget, at 2:30 p.m. That gives us an hour and 30 minutes to have a final discussion. So that's okay with everybody? Great.
Yeah.
I can entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? That carries unanimously. Yeah.